Here's how De Beers made you want to buy a diamond. Let's talk about it. One of the biggest assets in a married couple's relationship, the diamond engagement ring might be an emotional asset and a symbol of love and commitment. But in the financial sense of the word, it isn't actually an asset at all. In fact, it's worth at least 50% less than you paid for it the moment you leave the jewelry store. And yet we feel compelled to buy them for our loved ones anyway. So how did this become the norm? It's hard to imagine that it's only been 3/4 of a century since diamonds became the symbol of wealth, power, and romance they are in America today. And it was all because of a brilliant, multifaceted marketing strategy designed and executed by ad agency N.W. Eyre in the early 1900s for their client, De Beers. Over the course of a few decades, N.W. Eyre's helped De Beers successfully turn a failing market into a psychological necessity, all during a period of war and economic turmoil. So how exactly did N.W. Eyre convince Americans that diamonds are the ultimate symbol of love, romance, and marriage? What were the marketing campaigns that turned the diamond industry around, and were they morally sound? So let's take a critical look at how the company used marketing to create and manipulate demand for diamonds from nothing. Diamonds haven't been rare stones since 1870, when huge diamond mines were discovered in South Africa. Soon after the discovery, the British financier behind the South African mining efforts realized the diamond market would be saturated if they didn't do something about it. So in 1888, they set two audacious goals. One, monopolize diamond prices. They succeeded by creating De Beers Consolidated Mines Limited and taking full ownership and control of the world diamond trade. While they stockpiled diamonds and sold them strategically to control price, De Beers chairman Sir Ernest Oppenheimer cultivated a network of wholesalers all over the world. Number two, stabilize the market. To succeed here, De Beers would have to figure out a way to control both supply and demand for diamonds worldwide. For this, they would need to find an ad agency. When De Beers began looking for an ad agency, the global economy was suffering and Europe was under threat of war. Their challenge was to figure out which country or countries had the most potential to support a growing diamond market, and then to hire an agency to implement a marketing campaign in these countries. Because of Europe's preoccupation with the oncoming war, the US was chosen, even though the total number of diamonds in the US had declined by nearly 50% since the end of World War I. De Beers hired Philadelphia ad agency N.W. Eyre in 1938. De Beers chose N.W. Eyre because of their ideas on conducting extensive research on social attitudes about diamonds, and then strategically changing them to appeal to a wider audience. N.W. Eyre did exhaustive market research to figure out exactly what Americans thought about diamonds in the late 1930s. What they found was that diamonds were considered a luxury reserved only for the super wealthy, and that Americans were spending their money on other things like cars and appliances. To sell more and bigger diamonds, Eyre's would have to market to consumers at various income levels. So how did he get more people to buy big diamonds in a bad economy? They needed to figure out a way to link diamonds with something emotional. And because diamonds weren't worth much inherently, they also had to keep people from ever reselling them. N.W. Eyre's game plan was to create a situation where almost every person pledging marriage feels compelled to acquire a diamond engagement ring. The concept of an engagement ring had existed since medieval times, but it never really was adopted. And before World War II, only 10% of engagement rings contained diamonds. With a carefully executed marketing strategy, N.W. Eyre could strengthen the tradition of engagement rings and transform public opinion about diamonds, from precious stones to essentially parts of courtship and marriage. Eventually, Eyre's would convince young men that diamonds are the ultimate gift of love, and young women that they're an essential part of romantic relationships. The ad agency wanted to make it look like diamonds were everywhere, and they started by using celebrities in the media. "The big ones sell the little ones," said Dorothy Dignam, a publicist for De Beers at N.W. Eyre. N.W. Eyre's publicists wrote newspaper columns and magazine stories about celebrity proposals with diamond rings and the type, size, and worth of their diamonds. Fashion designers talked about the new diamond trend on radio shows. N.W. Eyre's used traditional marketing tools like newspapers and radio in the first half of the 20th century. In addition to overt advertisements, they created entertainment and educational content, ideas, stories, fashion, and trends that supported their brand and product, but wasn't explicitly about it. N.W. Eyre's wrote, "There was no direct sale to be made. There was no brand name to be impressed on the public mind. There was simply an idea, the eternal emotional value surrounding the diamond. Their story was about the people who gave diamonds or were given diamonds, and how happy and loved those diamonds made them feel." Every one of De Beers' advertisements featured an educational tip called how to buy a diamond. "Ask about color, clarity, and cutting, for these determine a diamond's quality, contribute to its beauty and value. Choose a fine stone and you'll always be proud of it, no matter what its size." The agency saw tremendous success from their early campaigns. In just 4 years between 1938 and 1941, they reported a 55% increase in US diamond sales. Riding this success, N.W. Ayer began perfecting their marketing strategy in the 1940s. They wanted to convince Americans that marriage without diamonds were incomplete. A diamond is forever. These four iconic words have appeared in every single De Beers advertisement since 1948, and Ad Age named it the number one slogan of the century in 1999. Francis Garrity, who wrote all of De Beers ads from 1943 to 1968, came up with it right before bed one night after forgetting to brainstorm it earlier for the next morning's meeting. When she reviewed what she'd scribbled down the night before, she thought it was just okay. And after presenting it at the morning meeting, no one was particularly enthusiastic. So it's unclear why the slogan was chosen anyway, but it was a choice that would contribute greatly to De Beers' tremendous advertising success. Even now, a diamondisforever.com redirects to De Beers' main website. The slogan perfectly captures the sentiment De Beers was going for, that a diamond, like your relationship, is eternal, while also discouraging people from ever reselling their diamonds, as mass reselling would disrupt the market and reveal the alarmingly low intrinsic value of the stones themselves. At the very beginning of N.W. Ayer's campaign for De Beers in the late 1930s, the suggested spend on an engagement ring was 1 month's salary. In the 1980s, De Beers ran a campaign to reset the norm to 2 months' salary. The ad said things like, "Isn't 2 months' salary a small price to pay for something that lasts forever?" The story from the campaign stuck, and De Beers' 2 month salary rule is still widely accepted in the US today. But from the start, De Beers and their agency created and manipulated demand for diamonds by monopolizing the market, changing the American social attitude, and convincing people that a marriage isn't complete without a diamond ring. So, are diamonds the biggest scam in history, or is this a prime example of ingenious marketing? First, De Beers knew their product wasn't intrinsically valuable, like gold and silver is. So instead of marketing to their product, they mastered the art of marketing to value. In this case, the values and ethics surrounding love, romance, and marriage. No one was interested in buying diamonds when they conducted their first round of extensive market research, so they had to create that value themselves. Regardless of which side you're on, De Beers is a very interesting example to learn from. It's fascinating how De Beers and N.W. Ayer created demand from nothing by coming up with a story and value proposition around their products, and it's still successful today. Since the turn of the century, De Beers has effectively lost its monopoly of the world diamond trade, although they still bring in billions of dollars every year. But by marketing an idea rather than a product, they built a strong foundation for the $72 billion per year diamond industry and dominated it for a good 80 years. And that's a story worth sharing. So what are your thoughts? How will you show your love? If you like this video, hit that like button and consider subscribing. I talk about money and everything related to it, so don't miss out. And as always, take care of your money.